right. Harvest Party sign-ups going around. That's coming up October 28th. That is a Saturday. So we're, as usual, it's the usual things. We've got set up and take down. We've got folks to run booths. We're doing the chili feed again and the dessert. So just kind of getting an idea who can participate and be involved in that. So that'll go around for a couple of weeks, and we appreciate that. And check out your bulletin, the Christmas choir. Can you believe it? Christmas choir is basically here. Practice will be starting October 22nd. Would you like to? Linda's got
just,
something to
just
say.
Just really emphasize, too, it is community. We have people that come that you don't have to come to this church to be involved. So people who like to sing, and I haven't encouraged some of you yet that about it, but feel free to take it if you know somebody that enjoys Christmas music or would like to sing. We really invite them to join us. It's a lot of fun, right? We will have fun. This will be fun. Yeah, we just have 10 rehearsals. You have your own CD that will have your part on it, and or if you really want me to, I can send you an MP3 if that's better for you on your device, but let me know, and would love to have you join. And you could come try, and you don't have to stay, you know, you don't have to sign anything if you think that you decide that it's not for you, but we'd love to have you join us. So there you go.
Linda calls it Christmas community choir, but she still won't let me sing in it. Hallelujah, I know.
We need you for the narration. We must have you for narration.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. You're so gracious. So yeah, that's coming up, and there's handouts. What I've got back there, there's a little section on that literature table that has all these invitation cards. Let kids, people know about his kids, they're back there. The Harvest Party, we have invites for that back there. For the community choir, Christmas choir, that's back there. Men's breakfast is this coming Saturday. First men's breakfast of the season, 7 a.m. Saturday morning. There's an invitation that Tom Stafford is speaking. Tom Reed is in the wings, though. You remember? It's just if, you know, your name came up first in my mind, so, okay, there you go. But Tom's going to share with us, and we're excited about that for this coming Saturday morning. But there are invite cards for that to share with some of your friends and neighbors as well. We look forward to all that's happening there. So that's all there in your bulletin. Please read those things and check out what is coming up. We do want to pray this morning to for our village missionaries of the time. And also, again, welcome. If I didn't say welcome, thank you for being here. If you're visiting with us or you're a guest today, hopefully you won't be a guest for long. You'll be an old regular, right? It don't have to be old, just regular. Glad to have you with us. And I do welcome those who are joining us online. Thank you so much for being here. We're praying this morning for Pastor Chris and Bethany Jones, who serve the Lord in Nisland, South Dakota. So we're going to lift up them and their church family and community. We'll lift up Camp Creek Church and our time together this morning, as well as we look toward what God has for us today. Again, thank you for being here, and I pray God will bless our time as we gather today. Will you join me as we open in prayer this morning? Father God, we are very happy to be here today. We thank you that you do open the doors of this place for all who will come. And we're part of that all today that can be here. And Lord, your love is there for each and every one of us. And we are so very grateful for that. Father, this morning we are glad to gather. We know there are many churches in our community, in our nation, and around our world, Father, that are gathering today. And so we are grateful for those times to gather. As we're thinking even of our world today, we're thinking of all that's happened in Israel, and we do pray for all of that right now. We lift Israel up to you and the world situation, Father. And we know that you are the one, as we're talking about this morning, peace. Is it ever possible, Father? We know through you it is. And so, Lord, we are just asking for your peace and for your sovereignty that you're in charge. Father, we want to lift up the folks who serve you in Nisland, South Dakota, with Village Missions. We pray for Pastor Chris and Bethany as they serve you there. They're asking us to pray for their elementary through senior high youth ministries that are happening this fall, just working with all of the kids in their community, praying for opportunities to minister in their community locally, just ways that they can connect and for their fall women's Bible study, and looking forward to hopefully a men's Bible study for their church family. So we pray for these requests this morning. We lift them up to you, and we thank you for how you're going to work in that community and in that church for your glory. So we lift them up, Pastor Chris and Bethany and their church family, to you today. And Father, Lord, we just pray that you will invade our hearts this morning while we're here. Father, we just pray that today, no matter what may be going on in our lives, what may be a burden to us today, what may be a joy to us today, that we can bring it all before you. And Lord, we are grateful for that this morning. We love you, we praise you, and we thank you for this opportunity to be here in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, this morning, we're working through the fruit of the Spirit, and I don't know about you, I've really been enjoying this study. I've been enjoying preparing for this study. I've been enjoying looking at the different parts and pieces of the Spirit being poured out in this fruit way individually. Today, we come to God's peace, and what's in front of you there today, that wonderful promise from Jesus. I don't know how many times I've used this verse as part of a funeral service or a graveside service. The words of Jesus always speak so loudly and clearly, I believe. But Jesus tells us this morning, he says, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." I pray this morning, in whatever state you are in, whatever state I am in, that I might receive that peace from Jesus today. That it's for you. It's for me. And I want to take that in as we gather to worship. And we know that peace does come. It's from him. So it's really good to stay connected to him, isn't it? To stay leaning on him, to stay relying and trusting on Jesus. And we're going to sing about that and about some other things about peace this morning. So I invite you to stand with me. We want to worship the Lord together as we sing this morning. So let's rejoice in his goodness and his peace.
Leaning on the everlasting arms, leaning.
our praise today. And let's continue to sing and worship him.
It is well.
your mercy never fails me. All of my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will see all the goodness of God. Let's sing that part again. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All of my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, I will see of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. You have led me through the fire and darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. Sing it, church.
Faithful.
God is good.
All the time.
All the time. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Let's go to him in prayer. Let's thank him for his goodness in our lives today. Father God, we are grateful that you are a good God. Father, we acknowledge this morning that things that happen in our lives many times in the world around us are not good, Father, not good at all. Some things are very, very evil that take place. But Father, you are a good God, and you work out goodness in our lives, even in the midst of tragedy and dark situations. And you can only do that because you're God, and we're so grateful you are today, that you're in control, that you are sovereign, and you are the one calling the shots in our lives and in our world. So Father, thank you for your goodness today. And we know that your goodness was extended so personally to each one of us through your Son, the Lord Jesus. When Jesus came and walked this earth and lived amongst all the people, sharing your love and your grace and representing you, Father, so well, and then was crucified, died upon that cross for the sins of the world, my sins. Going there for me. Lord, thank you for your goodness that showed through so powerfully there. But thank you also that Jesus did not remain dead on the cross nor in the grave, but rose again in victory to give us that new life and that hope, that wonderful assurance of eternal life one day in glory. You are a good God. You are a great God, and we give you praise this morning for your greatness and your goodness. In the name of Jesus, amen.
You give life. It's your breath in our lungs.
all God's people can say, amen. You are welcome to be seated now as Laura comes to share scriptures with us about peace.
Good morning. As you heard, the gift of the Spirit that we're focusing on this morning is peace. And there are different kinds of peace. Peace with God, that is spiritual peace, and that is the most important. It affects everything else. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5, verse 8, Christ to make peace between himself and us. God doesn't want us to live disconnected from him. Peace with God doesn't come from something we do, but from what Christ did for us. Shall I just turn off the mic and use a loud voice? Romans 5:1 states, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And through him, God reconciled everything to himself. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth by means of Christ's blood on the cross. Colossians 1, verse 20. The Apostle Paul encourages the Philippians in chapter 4, verses 6 and 7, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. I was reading a commentary about this passage, and the writer pointed out Paul's use of the word guard. He will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Paul wrote this from a prison cell, and he was being guarded by Roman soldiers. But we are guarded by the sovereign God. He guards the believers' hearts and minds, and we can entrust him with all of our difficulties. For the kingdom of God is not a matter of what we eat or drink, but of living a life of goodness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. Romans 14. Verse 17. Another kind of peace is peace with others. The Lord offers relational peace, and he desires us to exhibit that to other people. The Bible says in Ephesians 2, verse 16, together as one body, Christ reconciled both groups to God by means of his death on the cross, and our hostility toward each other was put to death. The further we are from God, the more our relationships with others are messed up. The only way to have lasting peace with others is to be united as children of God. Matthew 5, verse 9 tells us that blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. And Romans 12, 18 says, do all that you can to live in peace with everyone. Work at living in peace with everyone, and work at living a holy life, Hebrews 12, 14. And finally, from 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 2, God the Father knew you and chose you long ago, and his Spirit has made you holy. As a result, you have obeyed him and have been cleansed by the blood of Christ. May God give you more and more grace and peace. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Laura, for sharing those. I think we've been finding out as we've been studying the fruit of the Spirit so far, love and joy, and today peace, that it's not only found there in Galatians 5:22. There are all these verses that talk about love, that talk about joy, and then today about peace. So, Laura, thank you for sharing those with us this morning. Well, we have junior church today, so if you are 3 years old, up through through the fifth grade. You are dismissed to go with Debbie and Jason this morning to head out to junior church. So have a good time over there. We'll see you back here when church is over. So anyway, thank you for being here today. It's good to have our kids here, and it's good to celebrate with them as well. Hope you're all having a good day as we move in through the fall season, some beautiful weather that we've been enjoying, and we'll continue to. I have another joke for you. You can talk to the Bordereaux about giving me a joke book for my birthday. I know. Just one. When someone needed a boat made, what did the people in town say? Very close. We know a guy. Yes, we know a guy. Good job, Rusty. You and Auntie Linda are right on these jokes today. Really are. So that's awesome. I don't know what that says. But anyway, you're right on them, so it's good. Well, it is good again to be with you today. Thank you for being here, and look forward to all that God has as we move into the fall season here, and different things happening, and Bible studies going on, and harvest party coming up. His kids this week. We're back for our second His Kids of the season. We start our classes this week, so be praying for that as we have the kiddos out on Friday afternoon. Well, if you were to pick a characteristic that you really need on life's road, because, you know, you think about it, we're all on life's road, aren't we? We're all trekking and traveling down this road of life. What would that characteristic be that you really would like to have in your life today? Maybe you long for some true happiness. You know, sometimes people are like, you know, I really need some happiness in my life today. There's a lot of sadness going on out there. There's a lot of difficulty happening, and I need some happiness. Or kind of going along with this, perhaps it's contentment. You know, we know a lot of folks, and maybe it happens to be you or me sometimes too, that are not very content in the situations that come our way. So maybe it's contentment. Now, here's another one. There's probably a big one that we'd all love to have fully and completely. Good health, you know. There's a lot of sickness that comes along, a lot of things that happen and touch our lives or lives of our family in the area of health and strength and all of that. And so good health might be something that you would like as you travel this road of life. However, it seems to me in our current world of unrest and upheaval, most of us probably would love to experience peace. And just as, you know, many of you know, yesterday it came across the headlines about what's going on in Israel. And it hits our hearts. I mean, the unrest that's in the world around us, and everything seems to be so volatile today in many different areas that, boy, wouldn't it be nice to have some peace? Well, if peace is what you're looking for, I think you're in the right place today, because that's what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about that peace. And a lot of it, like Laura shared, it affects us in different ways, and it's in different parameters of our life. And it's the fruit of the Spirit that we want to look at today in our fall series. We've been looking at this series called the Fruit of the Spirit series. It's a harvest of blessing in your life. And like I said, I think it's a double blessing. I think as you and as I harvest those fruit, that characteristics of the fruit of the Spirit in my life, I'm blessed by that. I mean, as I experience God's love, I'm blessed by that. As I experience the joy of Jesus, my life is blessed. Today, as I experience peace, my life is blessed. And I think as I rub shoulders with you and other people, your life can be blessed too. And the same goes as you have that in your life, and then as we rub shoulders with others. So it is a harvest of blessing for all of us. So far, we've looked at two of this fruit of the Spirit. We've looked at love, and we have looked at joy. And love and joy are two of the fruit that forms the strong base for the others. Peace is that third one, and that's what we're talking about today, is the peace of God and how that works in our lives. And so the title of today's message is that the harvest of peace. And the key verse for this fruit is Galatians 5:22. And maybe you by now have a marker in Galatians 5:22. We're coming back to Galatians 5:22 every week. So you should be having a, you know, as you look there a lot, pretty soon your Bible almost opens up there. If I was smart, I'd take this little bookmark and do that. What do you think? Yeah. This is the new Bible that Uncle Todd got me, and it's large print. Yeah. Not as large print as that joke book, though. But I can still read it. Look at Galatians chapter 5. Go down with me to verse 22. This is where Paul is talking to the Galatian Christians and to us about how to live by the Spirit of God. And if you remember way back when we started the series, we learned from Paul that if we will live by the Spirit, we will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. Isn't that something else? That's a statement. If you will live by the Spirit of God, if I will live walking by the Spirit of God, I'm not going to be gratifying and going out and doing all that stuff. Will I sin still? Yes. We all will. We are still human beings and we have a sin nature. But if we're walking in step with Jesus and His Holy Spirit, we're less likely to fall into all of that stuff of the flesh. It's still there. We know that. But we can squelch that a little bit as we walk by His Spirit. And then as we move down to verse 22, that's where Paul makes that distinction between the flesh and the stuff that's the fruit of the flesh. He says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love. We did that 2 weeks ago. Joy. We did that last week. Peace. That's where we are today. Peace as a fruit of the Spirit. Now, it's interesting to note that the word peace appears approximately 430 times in the Bible. Isn't that interesting? That's quite a bit. For it to appear there for us in a lot of different references and a lot of different circumstances. And we heard some of those references to peace in our scripture reading. Laura shared those with us this morning where the word peace is showing up. This is one thing it showed up in what Laura shared with us too, but the Bible makes it clear that we can only really enjoy the peace of God as we have peace with God. Do you see the distinction there? That what we're searching for in life really is the peace of God. I want to have peace. I want to be able to walk through this life of trouble and hardship and pain and still experience a peace from God, a supernatural, over-the-top type of peace that can't be explained by the world. We all want that. However, the Bible says that we can only really enjoy the peace of God as we have peace with God. And that's that relational thing where because of our sin and those things that we have done wrong, there's a separation between us and God. And Jesus came to take away that separation, to bring us back, and to give us a peace with God. So because of my sin, my relationship with Him was broken and I was afar off. I could do nothing to remedy the situation. I couldn't build anything high enough, strong enough, or do anything that could get me back to Him. Jesus did it all when He died on the cross for me. And as I believe in what Jesus did on the cross, as I put my faith in Jesus, there are so many ways we can say it, but the idea is of giving myself to Jesus and believing in what Jesus did, then I have a peace with God. I'm back. Reconciled is a word that we often use. I'm brought back with God again. My favorite illustration is seeing that gap that's between me and God and seeing the cross where Jesus died laid across that chasm like a bridge. And I like to say I've walked across the cross of Christ. I have been reunited to God by walking across the cross of Christ, believing in Jesus. That's where I have peace with God, and because of that, I can have the peace of God. Does that make sense? I think that's important as we talk about peace, and it's very biblical. So having peace with God comes as we trust in Jesus. Having a relationship with Jesus Christ is a key to experiencing His grace on a daily basis and His peace on a daily basis. And so I pray today, if you have not come to know Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, that you would consider that. I would love to talk with you about that. If you have questions about what does it mean to know Jesus and how can I come to know him, I would love to visit with you about that. There are many here that you could visit with about that. And many of you here know Jesus. I realize that. Praise God for that. And again, if you don't, consider coming to know him today. So with the key to peace being knowing Jesus, I want to now share two pointers with you, just two today, on how we can harvest that wonderful fruit of peace in our everyday lives. So the first point deals with experiencing the fruit of peace, and the second point deals with sharing the fruit of peace. And if you want to take notes this morning, they're in your bulletin. There's an outline at the bottom there for you to fill out. Here's the first point I want to share with you. Harvest peace as you trust in the one who is in control. It seems that one of the strongest human desires is for peace, whether it be peace between nations, peace between neighbors, or even peace within our own minds. Over the last couple of years, we have experienced unprecedented global anxiety. People are stressed about finances, children, work, relationships, sickness. The list goes on. And you know, I'm testing God on peace because I still have not changed my startup page from MSN. You know, we've talked about that. It's bad news again and again and again and again. And every time you look at it, it changes to something worse. Anyway, most of it doesn't happen. I wanted to change that because it's so negative. But then I thought, you know what? I can look at that and I can say, I can still have peace because God's in charge of all of that stuff. So we have a lot of things that can rob us of peace. And in times of unrest, it's important to get a grip on the fact that God is in control. The theological term for this is sovereignty. That's hard to spell. It is. You write it out and you pretty much got it, but then you've got an I wrong or a G in the wrong place or too many E's or whatever. But sovereignty, spelled correctly there, the sovereignty of God, it is a big deal. It really means that God's in control. But we need to grab a hold of his sovereignty. Like I said, it's a big deal as we face all the uncertainties in life. And in the midst of the many reasons to worry, we have God's word telling us that there is a different way to go about life. And that different way is to trust in the fact that he is in control. God's got this. I like that little phrase. I know some little phrases can be trite and overused, but I've used this one over and over again in situations that come up daily. Something comes up that's upsetting. Something comes up that seems out of control, and I'm not sure how I'm going to deal with it. God's got this. Can you say it with me? God's got this. I think you're going to need to use this little phrase this coming week. I bet you are, you know. There's going to be something that happens. There'll be something that takes place. You'll get that phone call. You'll get that text. And you're going to have to say, God's got this. God's in control of this. God is sovereign. When the Apostle Paul wrote to the Philippian Christians, he gave them some insight into how to receive the peace of God. Will you go with me? You can keep your finger. Well, no, you don't have to. You can just put your bookmark in Galatians. We won't come right back to Galatians. But go with me to Philippians. It's a little further back in your Bible there. Not too far. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. God eats popcorn. I need all the help I can get in memorizing where things are. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, chapter 4, verses 6 through 7. Philippians 4, 6 through 7. You've heard this before. You've probably memorized it. Maybe you still know it. Do not be anxious about anything. but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. You heard this already this morning. Laura shared this with us. It's a wonderful verse about peace and how it comes to us. I want to break it down as to what we should do when things seem to be falling apart around us. Here's the first thing, what not to do. Worry. Isn't that interesting? It's very clear. Do not be anxious, or you could say worried. Worry works for anxious. Do not be anxious. Do not be worried about what? Anything. What? Sure, I know I shouldn't worry about, you know, maybe a slow leak that I've got on the lawnmower tire. But what about that great big huge thing that I just got news health-wise about? No, it says what not to worry, what not to do. Do not worry about anything. Lawnmower tire, slow leak, or severe health issues. Don't worry. Does that mean you don't care? No. I think we get confused with that. If you're not worried about it, then you're just being flippant and you're not caring about it. And that's not what it's saying. So what not to do? Don't worry. This is the normal human reaction. So when it happens to you, join the club, right? Because when things happen that cause us problems and irritations and whatever else, we do tend to worry. And I am a worry wart. I can be, very much so. I inherited that from my mother. She was a lovely, wonderful, godly lady, but she did worry about things, and I took that on. So anyway, and so this really speaks to me. Do not worry about situations, okay? But what I think is so important is when you take away something in your life, it's always good to replace it with something else. So Paul doesn't end there and just say, okay, don't worry about anything, go on your merry way. He gives us further instructions. Look next. It says, what to do? Pray. And he says, pray with thanksgiving. Do not be anxious about what? About anything, but in what? Every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. So instead of worrying about it and fretting about it and getting all anxious and upset about it, take it to God in prayer. And that sounds so simple and so easy, but it's not as easy as it seems because we spend the time worrying. But we're supposed to pray, and it says to do that with thanksgiving. Isn't that interesting? Thankfulness is something we take really for granted. To be able to pray and say, God, there's this situation now I'm giving to you. But I want to thank you in the midst of it. Maybe we're not thanking him. And he doesn't say we have to thank him for that horribly negative health report we just got. He doesn't say we have to thank him for that. But God will use that to give us something to be thankful for, I believe. So what not to do? Don't worry. What to do? Pray about it. Give it over to God. Maybe you give it over to God a number of times a day. Maybe it's moment by moment. Lord, take this. Lord, take this. I don't want to fret and worry about it. So instead of our normal reaction to be worry, may our normal reaction be prayer. And by prayer, and I've heard this somewhere and I've shared it with you numerous times, I believe prayer is declaring our dependence upon God. So when you say, I'm not going to worry, I'm going to pray, when you pray, you're kind of releasing it. And you're saying, God, you've got this. You're in control. I am dependent upon you to work in this situation, and I'm trusting you to be in control of the seemingly out of control situation. And so that's how we're to pray. To give that into God's control. There's so much that goes on around us that we don't understand. And it doesn't make sense, and we don't agree with it, and we don't like it, and on and on and on and on. But to come back to that point that God's got this. God's in charge can do a long way by relieving the worry and the anxiety that's there. And then notice, what not to do is worry. What to do is pray. What will happen? Look at what Paul goes on to tell the Philippians and us. What will happen? He says, you present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. So as you try to not worry, you lay the worry aside, and you pray, God's peace is going to be there. And I love how Laura shared about that, because it is an interesting term that Paul used, that God's peace will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. God's peace will guard that. And like Laura shared, that whole point of Paul wrote this from a prison cell. Guards were all around him. He got that idea that they were guarding him. Here's something else to consider with this terminology. Like an army attack, negative circumstances come at us. And that's what it can feel like. Negative stuff comes at us one thing after another. Unrest, upheaval, and uncertainty charge our way. God's peace is a protection against those attacks. God's peace guards us from those things that come our way. Satan will do anything he can to discourage us, to get us worried and frightened and all of that. And it says here, if you will pray with thanksgiving, if you'll give this to God, if you'll trust in his sovereignty, he is going to guard your heart. That's the center of you. That's the center of me. That's the thing that, you know, is often most vulnerable. God's going to guard our heart. And this is another one, our mind. Mind's right out there, you know. A lot of stuff comes through our mind. He's going to guard those things as we trust in him. So as we submit the situations and the circumstances in our life to God and realize that he's fully capable to handle them, we will begin to experience his peace. And it's a peace that it says here goes beyond human understanding or explanation. And I know if you've experienced the peace of God in a situation around other people who don't quite get it, they don't understand. Maybe they said, how on earth can you be calm right now? Your life is kind of like falling apart. Thanks for reminding me. How can you be calm? It's a peace of God that the world doesn't have nor understand. It goes beyond human understanding. So in other words, we shouldn't have it. We shouldn't humanly have a peace about a certain situation, but God can bring that to us. Peace, I believe, is very much tied to knowing that our God is in control. I don't have peace when I try to take the controls, but if I give it to him, a peace comes. Here's the second and last one for us today. How do we harvest peace? The first one was experiencing it. This is how we share it. Harvest peace as you become a peacemaker. In the famous Beatitudes in Matthew chapter 5, Jesus tells us these words. They're up here for you. He said that blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. So there's an advantage to being a peacemaker. I believe that one of the flavors, if you will, of the fruit of peace is that of being able to bring peace into situations of strife and disharmony. Can you bring peace into the situations of strife and disharmony? In our world today, there seems to be lots of situations like that. You just say the wrong thing on Facebook and strife and disharmony erupt. You say the wrong thing in a conversation and strife and disharmony erupt. You know, I mean, it's all around us. We're very volatile today, unfortunately. We're very volatile. And so here, how do we be this peacemaker? I don't think we're really exhibiting the true fruit of peace unless we are able to share some of that peace with others around us. So what I'm saying is, it's all right for me if I'm just here and I'm in this wonderful, peaceful situation and it's just great. I don't think that peace is really complete until I share it with you too. that you can experience that peace, and I can help you, and then you can also help me with the peace that I need in my life by being that peacemaker. Of course, this ability to be a peacemaker comes from our Lord. Think of one of Jesus' titles that we usually hear around Christmas time, Prince of Peace. Remember, Isaiah said that Jesus, as he comes, he will be called the Prince of Peace. So Isaiah, the prophet Isaiah, was identifying Jesus as being the one who would come on the scene of time and bring peace. The ultimate peace that Jesus brings is in reconciling mankind back to God by dying on the cross for our sins. He made the way for us to have peace with God, as we talked about earlier. And I think that's what's important to know. And we know a lot of the people, when Jesus arrived on the scene of time, hearing Isaiah's prophecy that he's going to be the Prince of Peace, they expected a different kind of peace. They expected all this peace to come over the world, over the government, over all of that. That's not what it was talking about. In fact, when Jesus came, it became a little bit more tumultuous, didn't it? He stirred some things up as people were living in that time. And so today, you know, it's not that kind of peace. I think it's great to pray for the peace in situations such as Israel. And I mean, all around our world, there's things that flare up all over, to pray for God's peace to invade those situations. But the peace that Jesus came to bring was that reconciliation between us and God through his death on the cross. And he made the way for us to have peace with God. And he also empowers us to bring peace into our daily circumstances. Now, there are many ideas out there on how to be peacemakers. I just want to share a few with you. You can fill in the blanks if you can here. I like the sign, Peacemakers Wanted. Here are some things. Here's what a peacemaker looks like. And maybe you can look at this at your own life and identify if this is you or not. And how can it be you if it's not? Here's one. A peacemaker has God's peace. A peacemaker has God's peace. Take time to grow in your relationship with God and ask him to remove your fear and fill you with his over-the-top peace. I really can't be a peacemaker until I have that peace that comes from God. So that, yes, there we go. A peacemaker has God's peace. A peacemaker has God's peace. There's some references there for you as well that talk about that a little more detail. We're not going to go to all of them today. Here's another one. A peacemaker has genuine love for others. A peacemaker has genuine love for others. Make love your goal, encourage and build each other up so your relationship is built on a strong and healthy foundation. So a peacemaker, I really believe, has a genuine love for others, not always self-centered, not always interested in, you know, I, me, and my, but looking out for others. A peacemaker, thirdly, prays. I believe that's important to be a peacemaker. We pray. We pray about situations. We pray about circumstances. We ask God to give us wisdom, direction, and peace. Ask him to help you listen with compassion and to give you words that will help, not to hurt. Because peacemakers often intervene in situations and try to help situations. Here's another one. A peacemaker builds trust in relationships. A peacemaker builds trust in relationships. Be truthful and trustworthy with others. Live with integrity. Reconciliation and peace are more likely when there is trust and honesty in the relationship. So a peacemaker builds trust. A peacemaker builds trust in the relationships that they have. A peacemaker identifies and addresses conflict. Know when it's important to confront and when it's better to keep silent. So that can be a hard one. A peacemaker identifies and addresses conflict. So you're trying to help conflict out. I was reading a little article, and I agree with some of it. It was talking about God doesn't call us to be a peacekeeper, but a peacemaker. And so they went on to talk about the difference in that. And I think the peacemaker, a peacekeeper will often try to keep peace at all costs, maybe not getting to the situation to resolve it. A peacemaker goes a little deeper in trying to address the conflict, which can be hard. Here's another one. A peacemaker controls his or her anger. Maybe when you're talking to someone about something, you know, and you're trying to bring a peaceful resolution, watch your tone and your body language, as well as the words you use. When emotions are high, it's hard to stay calm. We all know this. In our world today, like I said, things are so volatile. A peacemaker speaks the truth with love. And that references Ephesians 4:29. That's what it's talking about there. Choose your words carefully. Make every effort to communicate how much you value the person and the relationship as you talk about the problem. You see, peacemaking involves intervening in problems sometimes, relationship issues, situations where there's conflict, and trying to bring out some resolution to that conflict. And that's the last one. A peacemaker works toward resolution. That's the desire. If your heart is that of a peacemaker, you want to get things resolved. And we know that doesn't happen overnight. And it may not happen at the first attempt either. But the peacemaker works towards resolution. And as you look at those characteristics, and this is just a few, and this is just, you know, probably a whole lot that you could add to this list of what makes a good peacemaker. But as you look at this list, peacemaking is not easy, but it comes with the blessing of Jesus. In that beatitude in Matthew 5:9, it tells us that peacemakers will be called children of God. And I don't know about you, but I like that title. I'm happy to be called a child of God. And Jesus said that's what a peacemaker is. Blessed, favored are the peacemakers. They will be called children of God. So as we close our time together this morning about peace, I want to make it clear once again that to know Christ is to know peace. He is the one who brings it into our daily experience and makes it possible for us to share it with others as well. So what I'd like us to do as we close and to make this real practical is I want us to take a moment and as we pray together, I'm going to just lead you in some things to pray for. So you can close your Bibles now, but keep your bookmark in Galatians 5:22 for next week. I have my bookmark in there, and I also have my bookmark in my joke book, so I know where I left off. But go ahead and get your stuff put down. There you go. And let's just go to prayer as we close. I'm just going to give you a moment to bow your head and settle in. We do everything so rushed today. Just settle in with the Lord. And right now, I'm doing this just like I'm asking you to. Think of an area of your life that may be unsettling right now. An area of your life that you're worried about. And maybe there's good cause for that worry or anxiety. As you have that, turn it over to the Lord. Just with the Lord right now in the privacy of this moment in your heart, name that concerning situation. It could be anything. It could be a person. It could be a relationship issue. It could be a work issue, a health issue. It could be so many different things. But just name that before the Lord. And acknowledge his control over it. Allow him to be God in that situation. Allow him to take that situation and bring you peace. Give it over to him. And the second thing for us to do this morning is to think of an area of your life, as I think of an area of mine, where you could reach out as a peacemaker. Maybe this is at work. Maybe there's conflict that goes on. Maybe it's at school. Maybe it's with friends or relationships like that. Maybe it's in your home. Ask the Lord right now, as you give that situation to Him, ask Him to help you bring peace. Not just have peace yourself, but bring peace. God's peace into that situation. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For in the giving, it's in the giving that we receive. It's in the pardoning that we are pardoned. And it's in the dying that we are reborn to eternal life. Father, make us instruments of your peace this week. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Please stand with me. I want to send you off with the words of Jesus as you go forth today. It's been so good to be with you. I hope the time together has been good for you. It's been good for me. And praise God for what He's doing in our midst. Listen to the words of Jesus. Reach out and receive the words of Jesus from John 14:27. We started with these words. We end with them today. Jesus says, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled. And do not be afraid." Peace.